Hey everybody, it's Tom Lynn, and I'm coming to you today to discuss Biology is Ideology by Richard Lewontin. Richard Lewontin, a noted evolutionary biologist who did lots of work in population genetics, was an important colleague of Stephen Jay Gould. And in this book, though, he's not dealing with biology directly, but rather, as the name suggests, the fashion in which biological vocabularies, biological theories are invoked to justify ideological commitments that really, more properly, have a political or social character to them. What's happening here is the sociobiological or the evolutionary biological tact is attempting to ground our understanding of culture and society in a sort of biological determinism. The essay in particular, which I was going to concentrate on for today, is entitled The Story in Textbooks. And here, his antagonist is E.O. Wilson. You've probably heard of E.O. Wilson, or I think most recently, probably most famous for Consilience. But back in 1976, I believe, he published a book entitled Sociobiology. And Sociobiology was kind of a founding document of, I think, what is more commonly referred to as evolutionary biology, which also has advocates in people like Richard Dawkins. I would probably say Sam Harris. It's a way of seeing the world with which many of the so-called new atheists are quite comfortable. But Lewontin adeptly demonstrates that this approach is problematic. Now, what is this approach? This approach is the invocation or the calling upon categories of what is known technically as the neo-Darwinian synthesis, which is the synthesis of Darwinian evolutionary theory that relies on natural selection with genetics to provide us with an understanding and justification of what is happening in our society today. Now, this has, as Lewontin puts it, sort of a threefold structure. Number one is to assume that there is a fixed human nature. How does he arrive at this fixed human nature, or how does sociobiology arrive at it? And what it does is it kind of looks around at the societies of the world and says, okay, this is what's common to all these different societies. And, you know, it's a kind of a process of correlative induction, you might call it, to borrow a phrase of Wilfred Sellers. But once they have this sense of fixed human nature, they then proceed to assert, for various reasons to which we will turn in a moment, that it derives from our genetic constitution. And then having put that down, they take a third step and they say the reason we have this genetic constitution as opposed to any other is because it derives as an inevitable consequence of natural selection, of the trajectory of evolution. Now there's a conflation there between the fact that natural selection is a process that is stochastic, which is just a fancy word for relying on probabilities. There's nothing inevitable about the outcome of a naturally selective process. But you use a term and it sort of has a magical connotation, you know, that this is the way it is. We are bound by the mechanics of this process. And so that's A, B, C. And the uptake of A, B, and C is that then when you look at the state of human society today, you say, well, it couldn't have been any other way. And really, it's not going to be any other way because it is the way it is because of the laws of nature. So is this a scientific accounting? Well, it doesn't take very much to see that no, it is not a merely scientific accounting. But the language employed gives it a scientific feel, which then legitimates not just the account itself, but what the account can justify. What it really looks more closely at is how we justify the move of asserting that our nature is the outcome of our genetics. And he says that usually you've got three basic evidences given to ground that move. One is an appeal to the universality of certain characteristics. Well, if you look at it, people are like this everywhere. And so if people are like this everywhere, why are people like this everywhere? Well, it must be genetic. Because that's conflating or confusing an observation or perception with a causation or an explanation. So, for example, I believe the example he uses is, I think it's Lutheran, if I recall correctly. There's a largely Lutheran constitution to Finland. Does that mean that Finns have a gene which makes them Lutheran? Or whatever it may be. You get the point, you know. Are Russians, you know, if all Russians are Russian, is that because they've got a gene that makes them Russian? No, it's because they happen to be born in a particular geographical locale. But the second evidence granted is that there are certain features which we share in common with other animals, higher primates in particular, and you can use other species as well. And you say, okay, so the animals do these sorts of things as well, so there's some kind of genetic continuity. This is also problematic because it runs into the issue of anthropomorphic projection, where we take some element of the human world and project it into the animal world, but forgetting that we're doing this projection, it come back and be like, oh, look, we've discovered this aspect of the human world in the animal world, therefore must be part of nature and must have some basic in genetics, some basis in genetics. And so the instance he uses is how when we look at insect colonies, we use words like queen, they have queens, they have slaves, and you know, they're worker bees and they're drones and all that. And, you know, in part, it's linguistically convenient. But what's also happening here is we are using political, social categories to describe phenomena which are quite distinct from those categories, and then speciously conflating them. Okay, so that sort of approach, for instance, can be used to justify hierarchical orientations within our society. Because social animals have hierarchies, or male dominance, or aggressive competitive behavior, you know. And so the term I would use is hermeneutical naivete. He actually also notes that it's biologically naive to make these maneuvers because they don't appreciate the complexity of ecological, biological processes. In part, that has to do with the stuff that we were just talking about with reference to evolution as opposed to genetics in particular. The third evidence is a quasi-scientific appeal to heredity studies. And it's problematic for a few different reasons. One being sort of methodological, in that for a hereditary study to take place, you need some kind of genetic difference, not genetic homogeneity. And so if you're trying to find something which is common to all human beings in a heredity study, you run right up against the wall of contradiction that something which is universally present is difficult to square with genetic causation, as our genetic constitutions are actually diverse. genetic studies in this connection are looking at families and close-knit social associations. And it's pretty well impossible, given the nature of what you're looking at, to extricate the genetic component from the cultural and the environmental component. So members of a family are obviously going to share certain behavioral tendencies. But you can't really say that those behavioral tendencies are grounded in simply their genetic constitution, because they share the common environment, they share a common culture, and so on and so forth. It's almost a technical or mechanical point, but it's a technical or mechanical point with serious ramifications, because it's ironically convenient to those who would advocate for thoroughgoing genetic determinism, because we can't see into that black box that extricates these different contributing factors. They can just go ahead and say, well, ultimately it's all a genetic factor. So those are sort of some of the main points, and he goes into them in a finer grain detail as to why people who are advocates of sociobiology or evolutionary biology believe it is possible to ground an understanding of human nature in genetic constitution. He should also add that they often overlook in these analyses or underemphasize the enormous role that environment can play, and that the individual plays in relating with and forming their environment. To draw it full circle, we'll recall that this chapter is entitled A Story in Textbooks, and he uses E.O. Wilson's sociobiology as the point of departure and his sort of antagonist in this conversation. But that book, Sociobiology, becomes a template and really is a story that the story that it tells is a story that is told again and again. I've encountered it, and I'm sure you have as well, and not just in biology classes, but in economics classes and political science classes and so forth. But now we see it's a deeply problematic story that we need to interrogate. I want to come back to the first point, the description of human nature. What is human nature? The problem is that to try and get at a human nature necessitates abstracting from historical and cultural context. And you know what? It was kind of an accident that it happened this way, but it sets up nicely with this other video I did, where I looked at a little essay by Jean-Paul Sartre, Existentialism. Okay, he's like, well, what is human nature? Well, the nature of human nature is that it's indeterminate, both from the standpoint of the individual and from the standpoint of the society. It's something which we are constantly creating. So when you take something, a snapshot, and then use that snapshot to tell a story about what human beings are, you are closing yourself off from this more fundamental reality of the enormous flexibility of the human horizon, its openness in terms of who and what we are as individuals and as a society together. And we can go on from there, because Lewontin talks about how this is rooted in a particular problematic understanding of what it is to be an individual that we inherit from the Enlightenment. But you know what? You guys can read the book and find out what he says there. So that's my take on A Story in Textbooks, which is an essay inside of Biology is Ideology. Biology is Ideology by Richard Lewontin. And check it out, guys. There'll be links below. Thanks for listening.